Hi, this is Tall Bridge Guy. I already did the video, so this is kind of strange. I'm redoing the opening so I can explain it a little bit better. But what I wanted to do is a shear and moment diagram for this little beam right here. It's going to have a fixed connection on one end, it's going to have a hinge in the beam, and a roller at the other end. So the fixed connection holds the beam up, so that's why I can support the hinge, and then the roller helps out. And the reason you do these kind of problems is that they're determinant. You can use three equations of equilibrium to solve it. Professors love these kind of questions because they look complicated, but they're pretty easy to solve. So what does it kind of look like? Well, this is not the best drawing in the world, but if you have a fixed connection on the left, so this is a fixed connection right here, you have to have a fairly stout column, let's say, to hold your beam. If it's really thin, it might rotate and you might have kind of a pin connection. Well, let's say it's fixed, it's solid, it can take a big moment at this connection. So then I've got a load on here, the 20 kip load, and on this side here I have a 10 kip load, and in the middle here I have a hinge, and this hinge allows an X force to go and a Y force to translate from this beam over to this beam. Now, there's some other things we can look at. Here's some old kind of steel connections. This is a pin connection in, it's probably an old truss bridge, something like that. There's other kinds of things. There's these kind of connections. This allows, this is a cantilever on this side, and it allows an X and Y force to go. Typically, it's just a Y force, but if there is expansion contraction, it will restrain it from moving too far in the X direction. And I just saw this one over here. It's a concept for an earthquake pin, and the concept is it resists moments until the earthquake comes, and then this will break and allow some rotation in the girder here so that the building doesn't fall. It's not so stiff that the earthquake knocks it down. I don't know if it works, but it's an idea. So anyways, back to the video after this brief explanation. Thanks. Hi, this is the Tall Bridge Guy. I'm going to do a quick beam analysis, and then I'm going to show you how to do this beam in STAAD, and I just want to draw the shear and moment diagrams for this beam. And so what do I have? I have a fixed connection on the left. I have a roller on the right. I've got a 20 kip load up here. And a 10 kip load over here. The thing that makes it solvable just with three equations of equilibrium is this hinge here in the middle, and I'll show you why. So take a look at it. This will be A, this will be B, and this will be C. So you can go back to the start of the video and look at this and sort of see everything, but let's draw the free body diagram. So I've got a short piece of beam here. And what I'm going to do is I have a fixed connection over here, so I'm going to say that's MA. And then I've got, if I can fit it in here, AX, AY, and then I've got a 20 kip load here, 20 kips. And the distance to that is 5 feet. And then it's another 5 feet to the end of the beam. And now this is point B. And so if you have a pin, you have to decide what you want to do. But it can take a BY force, and it can take a BX force at the pin. No moment at a pin. And then the other side of the beam is over here. And you got to do equal and opposite. So this is BX again, equal and opposite, BY. I've got a 10 kip force up here. Oh, let's undo that. It's 10 kips. I got this new stylus and it's kind of driving me nuts, but I'm giving it a try. And over here I've got CY. And this distance right in here was 2.5 feet. And this distance was 5 feet. So we can start solving some forces. If I go to the left, so this is the left and this is the right part of the beam. The left, I've got a bunch of unknowns. I can't solve right off the bat. But if I go to the right, I can do something like sum the forces in the x direction equals zero. And if you look at it, I have nothing but bx, so bx is equal to zero. That's really fast. Staying on the right, if I sum the moments around b equals zero, What do I've got? I've got a minus 10 kips times 2.5 feet away plus CY. Oops, the stylus is not the greatest thing in the world. 7.5 feet. And everything has to equal 0, so equals 0. And I can solve right out of the way, and I get CY is equal to 3.33 kips. Now, staying on the right side, I can sum the forces in the y direction equals 0, and I've got 3.33 kips minus 10 kips plus by equals 0. That's a by. And I can solve, and I get by is equal to 6.67 kips positive up. So now I can go to the other side, and I can sum the forces in the y direction. And I get something like ay is equal to, no, not equal to, ay minus 20 kips minus 6.67 kips equals 0. Now, where did the 6.6 kips come? Well, remember by on the right here is 6.67 positive going up on the right part, but on the left side, it's negative. So you got to be careful with that. So ay is equal to 26.67 kips going up. I'm running out of room a little bit, so I'll erase a little bit. I'll just erase this piece in here. Keep the values, and I'll just start writing over here. I'm still on the left side, and what I want to do is I want to sum the moments around A. I keep forgetting the sum of the moments sign. But then I've got MA, that's what I want to solve for, minus 20 kips times 5 feet away, minus 6.67, and it's 10 feet away, and all of this equals 0, and if I solve it, I get MA is equal to 166.7 kip feet. Sorry, I'm making a bit of a mess, but it's in there. All right, so let's go and do the shear and moment diagrams. All right, so I've got a little mistake over here on the top. I show 366, but let me just erase it. It should be 166.7 kip feet. But look at it now. We're going to draw the shear and moment diagram. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is going to go up 26. So we go up 26, we go across. So this is 26.67. Nothing changes in there. Hits a point load of 20, goes down 20, and then it goes across. So this is now 6.67. 26.67 minus 20 is 6.67. It goes across, keeps going across until it hits this 10 kip load, right? Forget about the hinge. It's going to go down, and it's going to go down to minus 3.33, accounting for rounding, and then it's going to go up here back to 0. And it should add to 0 if you add everything up. Now for the shear or for the moment diagram. This is a little bit tricky. So when you have a moment like this, it's trying to cause the beam to bend up, which in our view is a negative bending. So the trick here is you're starting way down here at minus 166. We're going to take this area right in here, 26.67 times the 5 feet, and that's going to bring us up to a point about there, obviously not to scale, minus 33.33 kips, right? Minus 166.7 plus this positive area gets you to there. Now I'm going to take this positive area, it's another 5 feet, I think this is 2.5 feet. You add that 7.5 times 6.6, and that'll take you up to a point over here somewhere, and goes like this to 16.67 kips. Now I've got negative area in here, minus 3.33 times 5 feet, and that should take you down to zero. So there is the moment and shear and moment diagrams, and you can sort of see a few things too. If this is flat, this is going to be in an angle, right? That's the trick. So if this is flat, you're going to get this in the, on the moment diagram. If the shear diagram is like this, then you're going to get a curve on the moment diagram. So now let's go and try and solve this in STAAD. Hi, welcome to the second part. I'm going to show you how to use STAAD to find the shear and moment diagram of this little beam. So let's go to new project. And it's a plain structure, 2D. I'm just going to call it structure 1 and just overwrite the file. Go next. I'm going to add a beam and finish. So come up with a grid. I always go up to the top left here and I flatten it out. And I hate this snap beam stuff, so I just go right away and I just go, the first node is at 0, the next node is at 5 feet away, the next node is another 5 feet away, so that's 10 feet, there's a node at 12.5 feet, and a node at 17.5 feet. And I'll show you why this makes sense. You want to put your loads at nodes, it just makes it easier. So I've got to add a beam. I just usually click Setup, Geometry, and then go to this beam icon in the corner, and I add a beam. So next thing I want to do, General, I want to give it a property, so I'll just select everything. And we're doing simple properties, so it doesn't really matter which one you pick. Later on in life, it will assign. So I just picked a W6x15 shape. Now I'm going to go to support, and I have a node cursor, so I'm going to grab this node here, and I'm going to create a fixed support, first one that comes up, and assign it. I'm going to go over to this end here and create a roller. That's a fixed butt, so I'm going to release the X, the Z, and all the moments. You can only take a force in the Y direction and assign it. Now, I'm going to go up to here, scale, but you can also do labels, and it shows the node points. And, excuse me, this is where the hinge is, right here. Well, there is no support for that. So what you have to do is you pick a beam, and you go up to Commands, Member Specifications, Release. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to release the one end, the end of the beam, and I'm going to say it can't take a Z-force or any moment, and assign that. And what it's done is it put a little hinge at the end, or a pin. So I'm going to click on this side here, and I'm going to go to Commands, Member Specifications, Release, and I'm going to put at the start here a release, and I'm going to release everything except the X and Y, and I'm going to assign it and then close it. So if you go to your command file, Edit, Input, command file, you can see it. It's right here. I have my supports right here, supports, and then I have a member release. So member 2 at the end, these are released, and member 3 at the start, these are released. And what that does is that's my pin connection in there. All right, so next thing we want to do is load definitions. So we'll start a new load case, 1. I'm just adding it over here. Now I click on load case 1 and I'm going to add loads to it. And since I put nodes in here, I can put nodal loads. So nodal load, I've got a minus 20. I'm just going to add that to the right. And I've got a minus 10. I'm going to add that to the right. So I have them up there, but they're not assigned. So I grab my nodes cursor on the left here, grab my node, grab my force, and assign to selected nodes. Yes, please. And there it is. Now I can go up here and I can go to labels and say show the load values. Okay. And sometimes if you click on this loads, it makes it a little more reasonable. So next one, I want to grab this node here and this load, assign to selected nodes. And there is my structure. So I've got a fixed end, a roller on one, and I've got a pin in here. So now I can just go into analysis print. I'm not going to print anything. I'm just going to do a simple analysis. I add that to my chart, and I close it. If you again look at the input file, it tells you everything. It tells you the length of your members, what kind of steel you're using, your strengths, all sorts of things, your fixed supports, your member releases, your load types, and then it says perform analysis. So it has everything in the chart. You could go actually and just change any of this instead of going through STAAD. It's just a text-based file. All right, so let's go back to our loads. I'm going to hit analyze, run analysis. Hopefully I have no mistakes. Good, zero errors, zero warnings, done. Go up here to post-processing. I only have the one load case, so it already brought it over. Go OK. First thing I'm going to do is look at reactions. All right, and I can move them a little bit with this select text. Not bad. I've got a Y3.333. That's what I had in my hand calcs, and I have a 26.67, and I have a moment of 166.67. There's what my structure looks like. So now if we go to I-beam graphs, the thing about STAAD, since I split it up, you can only get one beam section at a time, but here's the one thing about STAAD. It shows the shear diagram right here on the right, just like we do, or the American way, I guess. Positive 26, and that's what I had on my moment or shear diagram, but it shows the moments opposite to what we typically do here in the States. And you just have to be aware of it. It's not a big deal, but this is actually a negative 167 in our system, right? So you can go and click on the beams and you can see how the sections change. And you can do one more thing. You could actually click on this one here, shear force, and you can sort of see the shear diagram. And I can go to results, view values, beam results, and I'll say shear at the ends. So I go up 26, I go across, I go down 20 to 6.67, I go across, I go down to negative 3.3, and I go across back up to 3. So that's what we had before in my shear and moment diagram. So let's see the Z direction bending. It's a little hard to see, so I'm going to scale it up a little bit. You go to bending in the Z direction. Just change the scale a little bit. Okay. And I'm going to put results on there again. View values, beam results. And I'll go bending and I'll turn that one off. Close. So you can see it's just upside down from what we typically do here in the States. And so it goes to 166. That's what I had. Goes to 33.33. That's what I had. Goes to zero at the hinge, which it better because there's no moment at a hinge. It goes to 16.67, and then it goes back to zero. So the other thing you can look at is the deflection diagram. It's right here. It's a little small, so we can go back to this and go displacement and change it. And you sort of see how the beam bends down from the loads, and it makes sense. So that's kind of a quick overview of how to use STAAD to use a pin or a hinge in a structure. So take a look again at the beginning, and good luck.